Alright, so first we're going to look at how to simplify radical expressions. Again, radical just means things in a root sign. Okay, so we're looking at simplifying things in a root sign. And specifically, I want to start looking at variables because I think that this is easier. And by easier, I mean like easier as in like easier than, I don't know, brain surgery or something. Okay, so this is always a topic that drives people crazy, and I think sometimes it's because it's usually covered at the end of the semester. People are tired, they don't want to do it. But this does take some brain power. So the first thing is to talk about, you know, what happens if you have something like the square root of x squared, okay? Hopefully you can look at that and say, okay, well, the square root of x squared basically means, well, let's try this. How about the square root of 4? You know that one, right? That's 2. Okay, well, remember 4 is really 2 squared. So the square root of 2 squared is 2. Similarly, you know, the square root of 9, right, is 3. So we could also say that's the square root of 3 squared is 3. So basically, the idea is if you're rooting something that you've squared, you just get the base number back. So if I have the square root of x squared, it's x. Similarly, if I have the cube root of x cubed, it's x. If I have the fourth root of x to the fourth, it's x. Okay? Does that make sense-ish? It should. I hope so. I can't really tell, obviously. But anyway, you know, that's kind of how we go at it. You know, like the cube root of 8 is really the same thing as, well, we know that that's 2, but that's the same thing as 2 cubed. So the cube root of 2 cubed is 2. Alright, now, when you're looking at this with variables, one way to look at it is, remember, like a square root kind of has like a secret 2 there. One way that I like to look at it is to say, okay, well, this is like 2 divided by 2 is 1 with nothing left over, right? Y'all remember doing that? 2 divided by 2, remainder 0. Okay, so I'm going to use this. But anyway, I've already showed you that this is x. It's x to the first. 2 divided by 2 is 1, and there's 2 divided by 2 is 1, and there's nothing left over. Right? Is that okay? Okay. Now, if I wanted to take x to the fourth and take the square root of it, this should also be reasonably accessible. There's actually a couple ways to look at it. You could say, well, it's x squared squared. So since I'm rooting something that I've squared, it's just the thing on the inside. Okay? So that's one way to look at it. The other way to look at it is to say, well, it's really 4 divided by 2 is 2 with nothing left over. So x squared. So the square root of x to the fourth is x squared. It's just 4 divided by 2. Okay? I'm going to do a couple more. So if I had x to the sixth, and I want the square root, it's just 6 divided by 2, which is 3, remainder 0. I'm writing the remainder for a reason, obviously. Well, maybe not obviously, but trust me. So it's x cubed. Okay, 3, remainder 0. The great thing about this is you can actually use this for all things that have variables in them. So like if I have the cube root of y to the 12th. Okay, that might otherwise give you pause, but it's really not that bad because you're just going to take 12 divided by 3 now, divided by 3 because it's a cube root, which is 4 with a remainder of 0. So y to the 4th. Okay? So let's try a couple more. Let's do like x to the 20th. Let's do the 4th root of x to the 20th. That looks really crazy. We'll do the the 16th root of x to the 32, just because I feel frisky today. So I've got 20 divided by 4, which is 5 remainder 0. So that means I have 5 with an n left. Then I have 32 divided by 16, which is 2 remainder 0. So I have 2 with nothing left. Okay, so that's where we're going with that. Perfect? Excellent. Well, let's talk about what happens whenever you do have a remainder. Okay, so now let's say let's say I have the square root of x cubed. Now, I'm not sure how much you care, but there is a formal way to do this. One way to look at it is to say, well, it's x squared times x, right? X squared times x. This is actually really important for where we're going with this. Is that okay? Hopefully. X squared times x. So the idea is I can pull one of the x's out, but I've got one left, right? Because I know the square root of x squared is x, but now I have this stupid x left. Because it doesn't have a pair. It doesn't have a friend, so it can't come out of the square root sign. Can make sense? Okay. So to draw an analog to what we were doing before, this is like 3 divided by 2 is 1, remainder 1. So I have 1, but there's 1 left over. So let's do, like, if I have the square root of x to the 5th. Now again, I could draw that out and I can say, well, it's the square root of x to the 4th times x. So, well, the square root of x to the 4th is x squared. And this is how I did it for years, but I think I like the division or remainder thing. It always made more sense to me. So, basically, you can say I have 5 divided by 2, which is 2, remainder 1, right? 5 divided by 2, 2 remainder 1. So, I have 2 x squared, 2 out, and I have 1 left on the inside. And I can just write that as x squared root x. I don't have to actually write the little 1 up there, but I know that there's 1 left over. This is more interesting, I think, when you've got, like, cube roots or something like that. So if I had x to the, 7th. Okay? So that's 7 divided by 3. Let's do that. 7 divided by 3. 2 with 1 left over. 7. I keep drawing this out because I just want to make sure that you understand what we're doing here. And I can't, like, look at you and ask. So, 2, remainder 1. So that means I have 2 and 1 left over. Oops. 2 and 1 x left over. So not so bad, right? Could be worse. I always feel like I say that when I teach math. Look, it could be so much worse than it is. It will be eventually. Does that make you feel better? Let's try the 4th root of x to the 11th. Okay? So we've got 11 divided by 4. That's 2 times 2 is 8. And I have 3 left over. 2 remainder 3. Now I'm checking myself. Yeah. 2 remainder 3. Okay? So it's 2 remainder 3. So I have 2. And now I have 3 left over. 4th root. That's right. 4th root. Make sure you got that. That was a mistake on my part. So the 4th root, and then there's 3 left over. And honestly, you can do this with cows. Cows come home. Cows, yay. Let's do x to the 10th, the cubed root. So you can say, all right. Three remainder one? Yeah, so that's 9. So, 3 remainder one. 1 left on the inside. I like to do cube roots because they're more interesting. But I think you're getting the idea. 14 divided by 3. That's going to be 12. So it'll be 4 with 2 left over. And if you can't do that in your head, it's fine. You know, just go write it out. Remember, you don't get extra points in math class by not showing your work. So, 4 remainder 2. So, I've got 4 and 2 left over. Not 2, I keep saying that. 2 left over. 2 x's left over. Alright, I'm going to do one more way. Don't mess it up. How about that? Is that a good idea? I like it. Let's do x to the 27th, because that would be something I would not want to do in real life. I don't know what this is. Apparently it's not. Yeah. 27 divided by 5, that'll be 5 with 2 left over. So 5 with 2 left over. Got it? See, not so bad. Now the fun part is that you can combine these with other letters, other variables. So I could say, let's do the square root of x to the 5th, y to the 7th. Now, if it makes you feel better, you can separate these out separately, and then separate them separately. Yes, you can totally separate them separately and then have two different things. So 5 divided by 2 is 2 remainder 1. 7 divided by 2 is 3 remainder 1. So I say it's x squared remainder 1 and y cubed remainder 1. And generally what we do is we like to pair together the things that are outside the square root sign and then pair together the things that are inside the square root sign. So we'll generally write something, a question like that in that format. Okay? Beautiful, right? It's actually not that bad. I don't mind doing the variables. The things that I don't like doing are the ones with numbers in them, like real numbers, because you've actually got to think harder, and I don't like to do that. That's totally silly. Let's do x to the 7th, y to the, I don't know, come up with a number. Numbers are so hard sometimes. Y to the 11th, z, c. There we go. We haven't done one like that yet. So if it helps, again, go ahead and separate them out. And if you don't want to, you don't have to. I'm not looking over your shoulder. I don't really care as long as you get the right answer legitimately. Like that. So, got 7 divided by 3 is going to be 2, right? Remainder 1. 11 divided by 3 is 3 remainder 2. Now, remember this is 1 divided by 3 is nothing, right? Remainder 1. I can't really do anything. I can't. This number is smaller than 3 because it's a 1, so I really can't pull it out. I just kind of got to leave it in there. So I've got 2, remainder 1, and I've got 3, must be a y, 3, remainder 2, and here all I have is just the remainder z. So now I combine the things that are outside, and then combine the things that are inside, and I am happy potatoes. Now, about the only other thing they can do when they just give you variables is to, like, throw something in the denominator of a fraction. But really, this isn't so bad. Say I have the cube root. I just like cube roots better. Of x to the 5th, y. Sure. And they divide that, say, by the square root of, or the cubed root of. Oh, that's what I want to do. Sorry. Let's do the whole thing. I'll just do a square for a moment. Let's do x squared y over z to the 5th. Okay. In a problem like this, you're going to remember, hopefully, that you can separate this out to where you have a 6, I think that promise. To where you can separate it out to where you have a square root on the top and a square root on the bottom. Okay. This is one of those properties of exponents and square roots that you can go ahead and you can separate this out into the top and then into the bottom. Okay, so you can say it's the square root of x squared times y times the square root of z to the 6th. Okay, if I do that, and the square root of x squared is x, y, and then on the bottom I have 6 divided by 2 is 3, remainder 0, so 3. Oops, okay, totally forgot. I'm not paying attention, am I? Sorry about that, but you thought I was crazy. X squared y, z cubed. Okay. Let's do one more where I don't mess it up. That would be awesome, right? Let's do the cube root. X to the 9th, z to the 12th, over a squared, b to the 4th. For lack of anything better to do. Because apparently I'm nothing else to do. Yay! So let's break this up into two parts. First of all, we can do it to the top, and then we can do it to the bottom. Okay, and now we can do it to each one individually. Aren't they lucky? Chunk, 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 chunk. Meow. Oh, I'm being more careful now because I feel like I keep messing up. Oh well, that's what you get for free videos. Okay, 2 divided by 3. Right, next to what I'm actually talking about. So 2 divided by 3, that's 0, right? 0, remainder, 2. 2 divided by 3. See, told him not paying attention. 0, remainder, 2. 4 divided by 3 is 1, remainder 1. 9 divided by 3 is 3, remainder 0. 12 divided by 3 is 4, remainder 0. So now I can write this out. I've got 0, remainder 2, so that means the s squared is still in there. 1, remainder 1. And then 3, remainder 0, and then 4, remainder 0. So then I can go ahead and I can write this out, where I put everything out front that belongs out front, and then I can a squared b over x cubed c to the 4th. And then that's my fancy pants answer. All kinds of exciting, right? Yay! There you go.